everyone. My talk cannot be as fun as some of my preceding speakers, but I'll try my best. I need a slide behind me. Oh yes, if you look at this slide, you see the person at the Arctic. Well, he seems the right side up, isn't it? And you see the person right below, the Antarctic, and he definitely looks to us to be upside down. But if you were to go down to that gentleman in Antarctic and ask him, why are you standing upside down? He'll laugh at you, because as far as he's concerned, he's right side up. So that's the story of life, actually. And that is actually the story of evolution. That everything that we look at in life, it depends on perceptions. On the perception of where you are, and how you are, and what you are doing. And the thing to remember in the world is that we all look at these five fingers. None of them are of the same size. They're all different. But if you want your hand to function, you need all of them. All your fingers need to have a dialogue and chat with each other. It's the same in human society. People have different ideas, people have different perceptions, and we need, as individuals, should not be dogmatic and self-righteous and think we know everything and we are the only ones who know the correct answer. We need to be tolerant, we need to have a dialogue. And this is some, and if you look at it, suppose our ancestor had not developed the wheel, where would we be? He turned the world upside down for the people at that time by changing the entire mode of transportation. So if you look back into the annals of history and you read all that has been achieved, every time when things have been turned upside down, that's the time that we have moved ahead. If things don't get upside down or the right side up, whichever way you want to look at it, society would have been static. And you and I wouldn't be in this room together with artificial intelligence staring us in our face. And this is something I've experienced in my own life, and I learned it very young, at a much younger age. Finished in the days when I was much younger than many of you here also in the 60s. What is it we were taught? You had to finish your BA because nobody wanted a daughter-in-law who was totally uneducated. So you did your BA not because you were improving your intellectual capacity, but you were suitable for the marriage market, so to say. And what were you to do thereafter? You had to be a good wife and a good mother. That was your role in life. And we accepted it without any questioning. But a magic happened in my life, which turned me, my life and my views upside down. Because I went to drop my young son at school, and the principal of the school, a Jesuit priest, came and asked me, can you be a substitute teacher for 3 months? And I laughed. I said, Father Principal, I've never ever taught in my life. Why are you asking me? He says, no, you will be able to manage. And a magic happened. Because when I entered the classroom and I started teaching, you know, I cannot even describe in words the kind of joy that came into me. How much I enjoyed doing what I did. And then the next magic happened. When the kids came up to me and they said, ma'am, can you help with this? Ma'am, can you answer this? And you know what I realized? That those children came to me and they knew me not as somebody's wife, they knew me not as somebody's mother, they came to me for myself. It was me. And that's when I realized, why should we not have a sense of identity? Women also need to have a sense of identity. That you may be a good mother, you may be a good wife, but you're also yourself. Capable of many competencies. But you know, that experience also made me grow up in two ways. One is, of course, realizing that one should battle for women to take their place in society. The second I realized about not being judgmental, because my in-laws were horrified that the thought that a daughter of their house goes out not to work, to earn a living. My initial reaction was anger. But then I realized, for them, I was turning things upside down. And I had to understand where it came from and not look at them as my enemy or hold it against them. And I'm mentioning this because in many ways, if I have succeeded in life, it is that learning that has always stood by me. Whether I work with children or whether I work with parents, it's that learning that always guided me in making my decisions, in helping me to understand that if somebody thinks differently from me, it doesn't mean they are bad. It doesn't mean that they are 100% wrong. We can all live together like the five fingers. After that, I decided I must do my master's because I got married soon after my BA. And what a lovely experience I had. I went into this classroom where everybody was much younger than me and I was very deep to all of them. But it was a remarkable experience in how it helped me to understand how generations are different. And it's a younger generation that takes the front. And you as the elder generation need to go down and look upside down and work with them and not try to bring them up what you imagine to be right side up. And I remember during my days of, because I had to attend classes, there were no correspondence courses, I also helped a couple to elope. And I was most excited about it till I came home and my horrified husband said, somebody is going to come and murder you. They belong to different castes. But I'm happy to report that they had been happily married for many years and nobody came to kill them or me. So, and also, you know, coming back, because my experience has been in schools basically, and I came and I was lucky, I was fairly successful in what I did, and I was heading a primary school which had 2,000 kids. At this time, I got an opportunity or a request to head a school called Sanskrit Youth, was yet to be born, and it had 35 students. And everybody told me, you are mad. You have made a name for yourself. You go to school with 2,000 kids. Why are you going to a school with 35 kids? And I had people who told me, you will move, you will destroy yourself, and your school will shut down within a year. Because I decided that I want to set up a school where every child will be recognized, not merely on grades. Because I firmly believe that everybody has some talent. And it is up to us educationists to nurture that talent and not depress children by telling them, why did you not get 80% or why did you not get 90%? And my two favorite stories are about this kid who came for admission. And his mother came in and I looked at the marks. They were quite dreadful. She said, you know, if you don't take my son, I don't care. I don't mind because I know he's very bad. You know, I felt so terrible. I said, I'm going to admit this kid. If a mother can say that for a kid, we have to do something. And we discovered his problem was he couldn't retain too much. So we coached him on 50% of the paper. He got another 50% and he passed. Do you know, today he's a graphic designer, bought a house in Delhi, in Nizamuddin, a very expensive area, and he has got married, and he's earning more than one can even imagine. And this was a child who was given up by his own mother. Then I had these two girls. They really drove me nuts, I have to admit that. Because the teachers would bring them in, what marks did you get? 8 on 100. 6 on 100. But they said, ma'am, we are trying very hard, but nothing ever happened. So just before the board exams, I called them in and I said, look, what are your parents telling you? Oh, they want us to get a 90. I said, look, I'm not telling you that. Get a 40%. So they said, oh, you don't have faith. I said, no. Get a 40%, you will be out of the system and you will be able to do what you want. Wow. Today, they are the most sought after wedding planners in Delhi.
Wow.
And when I rang them up, they said they are booked for the whole month now. So you see, we have to turn our thoughts upside down, because it's not grades that make a child, it's the innate talent and the character. What is important is to teach them the values that will guide them and help them to progress in life. Like in a kindergarten class, this child was coloring clouds, bright green. And the teacher was trying to tell him, beta, this is not the color. And then I stopped her. I said, did you ask the child why he wants the clouds green? So when we asked him, he said, I don't like the color of clouds. I want clouds to be like this. And I told the teacher, I said, let the child be, because that is his vision. There was another incident where, you know, the teacher was teaching where the capital of India is on the map. And everybody agreed and the pin was put and all. Then she removed the pin and asked some child to come up and see where is Delhi. But then put it somewhere up, high up in Punjab. So she said, but I have just taught you. So the kid turned around and said, but you asked me to put it where I thought it was. So you see, we can learn from the mouth of the babes. And teachers today and parents have to understand, like that little boy Sanai said earlier, and his cousin said, we are screwed. That is because we don't turn our thoughts upside down and listen to them in the world that they are living. Also, coming back to again the main topic, the buzzword today is disruption. So what is disruption really? When we talk about disruption, when we talk about the kind of school we want our child to go to, we say they should learn to be creative, they should learn to be innovative. How will they be creative, innovative, if they don't look at things upside down? They have to look at things differently. After all, what is creativity? What is innovation? It's thinking out of the box, it's thinking of new solutions, it's thinking of new ideas. So therefore, this whole concept of upside down completely actually confuses me. Is it upside down? Is it right side up? Mm-hmm. How do we look at it really? And if you really want to talk of things getting messed up, then we should say things are topsy-turvy. So the English language does give us a lot of opportunities, but we are now sitting on a cusp of true upside down. We have artificial intelligence and technology that have stepped into every part of our life. People were 100 also busy typing out on the computers and sending WhatsApps and emails, etc. So when we are in that kind of a situation, let's embrace it. And we should not look at upside down as a negative or a pejorative idea. It's an idea that actually fosters progress, that's how I would put it. It fosters excitement. It fosters intelligence. So upside down has a very wrong connotation as being a very negative feature. Actually, I think that's what has propelled society towards success, towards progress, and that's why we are all sitting here today. So thank you so much.